1919, immediately after the First World War, one of the largest black trade unions began in South Africa. It was called the Industrial and Commercial Union and was known to everyone as the ICU. In 10 years, it grew from 400 members to 100,000. Its growth showed the urgent need for black workers to improve their conditions of work and their wages. Who were these members? Beginning with the dock workers in Cape Town, members came from all over the country. The Land Act of 1913 left blacks with only 13% of the land of their birth. Deprived of this land, people were forced to move. Cash was needed to pay new taxes imposed. Cash was needed to meet the enormous rise in prices after the war. People sought work on farms. They sought work in town. Many of them became migrant workers, returning home once a year only to their wives and children. They had to carry passes which told the authorities and the police how long they had permission to stay in town and for whom they worked. Many of these migrant workers went to the mines. Conditions facing all these workers were often very unsatisfactory. This man looked after the tramline points in Johannesburg. Against this background, people desperately needed to unite and solve their problems in a trade union. What is a trade union? A trade union is an organization of workers formed to protect their own interests. Its strength lies in the fact that a worker is not alone. Thousands of his fellow workers live and work under the same conditions. It is easier for a boss to fire one worker, but not so easy to fire all his workers. A trade union bargains or negotiates with the bosses. If, for example, the bosses refuse to pay higher wages, a strike might be called by the trade union. Or, if in the eyes of the workers, someone is dismissed unfairly, the trade union may then plan a walkout of all workers. A strike is a decision to stay away from work until the demands for higher wages or other improvements have been met by the bosses. The union then organizes a special fund from which it pays the workers on strike. It is often very difficult to get enough money for this fund because members are not rich. If it runs out, it is very difficult for workers to remain on strike with nothing to live on. Instead of meeting the strikers' demands, the bosses sometimes employ other workers. These workers are called scabs. They often destroy the possibility of strikers getting better working conditions. What were conditions like in 1919? The First World War was over. In Johannesburg, the gold rush was over. The gold mines had been consolidated by very rich people like Rhodes into large companies with a centralized base, the Chamber of Mines. 200,000 laborers were needed to work the gold mines. New industrialists wanted labor cheap. They looked to the black population to fill these needs. Those people who had been deprived of sufficient land by the 1913 Land Act. People could no longer support themselves in the traditional way. The cost of living had virtually doubled because of the war. People had to have cash, so they had to seek work. Work was available as laborers. Laborers on the mines, in new industries. Laborers in the docks and on the railways and on the white farms. Thousands of black workers began to see their only hope lay in working together and forming a trade union. They saw that white workers had already formed trade unions, which did not include them. Take an example in Johannesburg in 1918. White electricity and gas workers went on strike and demanded a 25% pay rise from the city council, which they were granted. Black municipal workers who collected refuse in buckets from the lavatories of white families demanded a rise of 6 pence a day. When it was refused, they went on strike. They were immediately arrested in what became known as the bucket strike case. The magistrate said,
"While in jail, they will have to do the same work as they have been doing and will carry out that employment with an armed escort, including a guard of Zulus armed with assegais and white men with guns. If they attempt to escape, they will be shot down. If they refuse to obey orders, they will receive lashes as often as is necessary to make them understand they have to do what they are told."
It was this kind of response to legitimate demands of black workers that caused a man called Clemens Kadalie to encourage the Cape Town dock workers to form the ICU in 1919. 400 dock workers went on strike for 2.5 weeks for higher wages. They were angry that food was being exported to other countries while prices for it were rising at home. The migrant workers were threatened with expulsion, which meant they would have to return jobless to the country. Scabs were employed to load the cargo, in this case, white railway workers. Headlines carried the words, "Dock workers strike a failure." But although wages were not increased, the strike succeeded in gaining huge support for the ICU. Word of it spread far and wide, and people from all over the country joined it. The growth of the ICU. In Bloemfontein, Kadalie and Selbim Simang, who had been organizing workers there, launched the concept of a national union of workers.
"Agitate until Parliament trembles. I have come to liberate you,"
he told farm workers in the Transvaal.
A Standerton farm laborer responded.
Men, I thought we were getting our country back through Kadali.
In Port Elizabeth, where the ICU was being organized by Samuel Masabalala, it was again the dock workers who struck for higher wages. Masabalala was arrested. Workers surrounded the police station demanding his release. Some ex-servicemen took it upon themselves to defend the police station, opened fire and killed 23 people and injured many others. The role of the ICU was not going to be easy. Membership throughout the country, the government moved to divide the working class by protecting the interests of the white workers, but not the black workers. In the Transvaal in February 1920, white mine workers did not support black mine workers when they struck for better pay, protested against the caliber, and requested lower prices in the compound store. Some white workers even scabbed. No black wage increase was gained. Instead, police and troops were called in to surround the compound. Later in 1922, the mine bosses wanted greater profits, and so they proposed to offer some of the jobs of white workers to black workers at a lower wage. Fearing the loss of their jobs, the white workers led a rebellion on the rand and even attacked the black workers themselves. This time, the army was sent in to quell the white rebellion. However, the long-term result was to protect the white workers yet again by passing the Industrial Conciliation Act, which said, in so many words, that blacks were not considered as employees within the meaning of the act and were not, therefore, permitted to bargain for higher wages. Against this kind of division, often resulting in legislation which entrenched opposing interests among workers, the ICU grew. By this time, the ICU had moved its headquarters to Johannesburg, where a young member of the Communist Party, Thomas Mbeki, ran the office. He said to the black workers,
walk on the pavement, side by side with the whites.
The people began to be free to move on the pavement, away from the streets and cars, side by side with the whites and rubbing shoulders with them. Mbeki brought us to this position, for we used not to mix.
In Natal, it was George Champion who helped to build the ICU. Zulu speaking, Champion had left in Standard 6 and worked for many years as a timekeeper on the gold mines, which he eventually left to work full-time for the ICU. His main task was to help farm workers to organize. They were the lowest paid workers in the country. Some were tenant farmers working under increasingly impossible conditions. After a meeting on the wage dispute in 1926 in Bloemfontein, at which 10,000 people were present, Kadali was banned from entering Natal. However, he defied the law and addressed 8,000 workers there, encouraging them to defy the past laws. News and resolutions of the ICU were spread throughout the country by their own newspaper, the Workers' Herald, started in 1923. But legislation dividing workers continued to be passed. In 1924, Parliament was debating the wage bill, the so-called civilized labor policy. This was to give priority to white workers for any job where they might compete with the black workers. A minimum wage for workers was to be set by the minister according to European standards. For black farm workers and domestic workers, no minimum wage would be set. Although at one stage impressed by Prime Minister Herzog, Kadali was scathing about the wage bill. Addressing the workers, he said,
"We have white people who have come here with the professed idea of civilizing the black man. By what means? Has civilization ever been introduced into a country through the instrumentality of oppression, of tyranny, and of Iron Heel method to crush and grind down democracy? This civilized labor policy is nothing less than an attempt to oust you from every sphere of labor and to place you in such a state as to imperil your very existence and exterminate you."
Kadali had won thousands of supporters by his charismatic presence and his fiery speeches. But these workers had also been promised action. They expected active support from the ICU for their strikes, for better conditions and for higher wages. The ICU did not take a militant stand when its members were evicted off land in Natal and their hearts bent. Had it become a populist movement instead of a trade union? By 1926, many of the leaders were not workers. Quarrels began to break out among the ICU leaders as to what to do. Kadali wanted international recognition for the ICU. He therefore sought to make contact with British trade unionists. Through the auspices of three women, one of them, Miss Holtby, was influential in liberal and socialist circles in Britain. The others were South African Mrs. Lewis and Mrs. Palmer. Tension grew between these liberals and some of the executive members of the ICU, who were also members of the Communist Party, which was still legal in South Africa at the time. At an executive meeting of the ICU in December 1926, the liberal element dominated and the communists were expelled from the ICU. Among them were executive members like John Gomez, James Laguma, and Eddie Kali. One member, Thomas Mbeki, who ran the ICU transfer office, left the Communist Party. The ICU restated its position.
Mrs. Lewis immediately wrote to the Prime Minister, Herzog, describing Kadali as
an individual among natives who is willing to follow powerful moderation and turn his back on the violent principle, the execution of which the White Communist Party had hoped to use him.
Herzog was unmoved. Meantime, Kadali left for Europe in June 1927. Although international trade unions were sympathetic, Kadali did not get the recognition he wanted. He agreed to invite a British trade unionist, William Ballinger, to come and assist with the financial problems of the ICU, which were many.
At home, legislation helped support the ICU and make it more cautious. Tillman Rose, Minister of Justice, said,
"There is a native menace in South Africa, and whites will be driven into a united party to fight for what we believe. We will rule the natives."
In introducing the sinister hostility law, he stated,
"Any person who utters words or does any act or thing whatsoever with the intent to promote any feeling of hostility between natives and Europeans shall be guilty of an offense and liable on conviction to imprisonment."
Blacks continued to be called boy and kefir, while whites were provided with an easy legal weapon. By its action in seeking to gain recognition, both by the South African government and by international labor, and by further quarrels amongst the leadership, the ICU was distracted from its main task, workers' needs. It had not met these needs in two recent strikes. Dock workers in Durban and railway workers in Johannesburg. It appeared to be impotent in dealing with the plight of thousands of tenant farmers being pushed off the land in Natal. The ICU had financial problems. There were accusations about the misuse of funds.
Mrs. Lewis turned on the ICU and said,
"A bankrupt, discredited, chaotic association of incompetent natives with a few struggling, defeated officials who had never been able to handle money or to protect themselves from the truly scandalous exploiting of their money by white men only out to line their pockets. Unable, too, to save their organization from the appropriation of funds by dishonest native officials."
Yet S.J. Sithebe thought differently. "I plead you to look and see how, who eradicated the ICU to such irrecoverable inefficiency and recklessness. Is it not the lulling sweet mouth of white friends, the political chameleons?" Nobody spared the insults. Things came to a head in 1928. Branches collapsed and broke away. Suspended by the ICU Congress for the misuse of funds, Champion formed the ICU Yasenatal. Ballinger's section became the ICU of Africa. Kadali himself formed the independent ICU in East London. Squabbling among the leadership was often purely personal, but perhaps, as a recent historian has suggested, Kadali and Champion relied more on charisma than organization. Who or what was to blame?
Champion said,
"It is no use wasting time about the shortcomings of Kadali. He has done what no man ever did. He has a clean record. He is the only black man who has led his people for 10 years, enjoying their confidence. Today, Kadali has soldiers but no officers. He is a field marshal without generals. He must fall, and that is the end of him."
Whatever people said, and whatever the findings are of why the ICU broke down, it was a remarkable attempt to unite black workers nationally. It had even spread as far as what are now Zimbabwe, Zambia, and Malawi.
John Gomez, the ICU executive expelled for being a communist, said,
"The ICU taught us much, but it taught us even more when we were expelled in 1926.
The ICU failed to teach the necessity of organization, strategy, tactics, and patience, and wasted revolutionary energies almost completely."
But Champion believed that
the ICU, with all its shortcomings, must boast of being the pioneer trade union that pioneered the trade union movement in South Africa.
Today we read daily of the increasing spread of black trade unions in South Africa. These are some of them. Can these trade unions learn anything from the successes and failures of the ICU? Can they learn anything from the experience of the ICU?